Hello, do you hear me? Okay, great. Let's start. I want to welcome you all. My name is Patricia Nobbe. I'm Associate Director of the European Union Study Center here at the Graduate Center of the City University. And I would like to welcome everyone to our panel, The Anti-Europeans, a conversation about the future of Europe. I hope you will. We are all able to grab a sandwich and get something to drink. You can enjoy the conversation and the following Q&A. So we are holding this conversation with a very distinguished group of experts, which I'll very briefly introduce. Our special guest is Professor Claus Leggewie, who is visiting from the Justus Liebig University in Giessen, in Germany, and who is also director of the Institute for Advanced Study in Humanities in Essen. Professor Leggewie has widely published on participatory, democratic, and European questions. More specifically, he has so recently published a book called The Anti-Europäer, The Anti-Europeans, that hasn't been translated into English yet. But this book and the thesis of the book will be what this conversation is being based on. Also on the panel, Professor Christine Landfried from the University of Hamburg and currently at the NYU School of Law as Senior Emil, Noël Fellow, and she has also been recent Director of the Center for European and Mediterranean Studies at NYU, and she'll provide a few comments. She also has extensive European research background, having published on questions of European politics and the European public and identity, Germany, as well as judicial questions, for instance, in a most recent book of 2013 on the never-ending crisis, Germany and the future of Europe. Then we have John Torpey, director of the Royal Bunche Institute for International Studies, also here at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. He will join the conversation as well as serve as the moderator. His work includes citizenship and state questions, European and transatlantic issues, including analyses of integration of Islam on either side of the Atlantic. His latest book, for instance, was on the legal integration of Islam, a transatlantic comparison, in 2013, together with Christian Jobke. And finally, our big and great thanks goes out to all the co-sponsors of this event, the American Friends of Fusarius, the Ralph Bunche Institute for International Studies, and NYU Deutsches Haus. And as Professor Leggewie's Institute for Advanced Study in Humanities is part of the University Alliance Ruhr, a representation of three universities of the Ruhr area here in New York and our co-sponsor, our very special thanks goes out to their office and its director, Peter Rosenbaum, who established the contact with the speakers and truly made this event happen. And I'll now hand the microphone over to John first.
I think the introductions have been done satisfactorily, so I think I want to just invite Claus Leggewie to basically give us a short version of the arguments of the book, and then Professor Landfried and I will have a few comments, and then we'll open it up for discussion. So,
thank you, John. Thank you, Christine. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming. I will talk about this recently published book, The Anti-Europäer, The Anti-Europeans. People who know me know that I rarely go for doomsday scenarios, which in this book is the case. Mostly I am a very positive guy. I talk about participatory democracy. I talk about the future of Europe. I even talk about the chances that we might have in Europe and all around the world with an interesting approach to climate politics, meaning that it's not just a disaster story, but gives us hope for investments and innovations for the future. So mostly I'm on the optimistic side. Last year I have dealt with monsters. And maybe you know this famous drawing by Francis Goya. It's called The Sleep of Reason produces monsters. Der Schlaf der Vernunft gebiert Ungeheuer. And I was dealing in this book with three monsters, which I would like to introduce to you as examples for anti-European sentiments, anti-European Weltanschauung, anti-European movements, anti-European politics in general. Maybe if you are a fan of crime stories or movies, you always find this scene there's a murder and those who are kind of freezed because there is somebody murdered are asked, do you have enemies? And the answer mostly is no. Not that did he have enemies, you know, the victim, and mostly the answer is no, not as far as we knew. He doesn't have enemies. So this is in a way the mood, in the general mood in Europe. There are enemies within and enemies without Europe, and most Europeans wouldn't simply recognize that there is a danger stemming from these ones. And this is the reason why I wrote this book. This has been published with Edition Zurkamp in Berlin just recently, and this is an intellectual history of anti-European Weltanschauung in the recent time, mostly published in the internet and mostly dealt with in conservative circles. So the situation of Europe, I don't know how you evaluate it here in New York, in the United States, at the last G20 summit. EU politicians and those of the member states realized that they don't have many friends anymore. Because of the debt crisis and Brexit, Europe is considered an association of individualists, politically torn and itself going downhill economically. I remember when I was at NYU in the mid-90s, this was exactly the same situation. Germany was a sick man of Europe, and Euro, the introduction of the Euro created lots of worries and signals of crisis here. And this, I think, is the general perception, not just in Europe, but also all around the world. North and South America turned their focus increasingly to the Pacific and away from the Atlantic and the newly industrializing countries and emerging markets, even if they are currently somewhat sagging, see themselves as future champions of the global economy, and particularly China. So the position of the EU is relatively low and mediocre. Because of this, EU and Europe opened much less confidently than just a few years ago, and in their hesitation confirmed this perception. Europe bashing is en vogue in Germany too, but of course in England, in Poland, in Hungary, in the Netherlands, in Scandinavia, Austria and France, the majorities distance themselves from the EU, and Eurosceptic parties are on the rise. I just got to know that the leader of the German Alternative für Deutschland, Frau Petri, had a meeting with Marine Le Pen in Paris for, you know, coordinating the right-wing international in Europe. And in the South, plagued by austerity measures, Brussels and Berlin get terrible press. The mood in Germany is more Europe-friendly, but even there, Europe's reputation is that of a bureaucratic monstrosity. This is what you always hear, you bureaucratic monster. If you compare the administration of a city like Frankfurt with 650,000 inhabitants and compare this to EU bureaucracy, you will find out that the Frankfurt administration has more members than the EU, the whole EU. But nevertheless, it's perceived as a monster, far away, distant to the people, no relation, alienating people in Europe. And somehow doesn't trust in the old world to still deliver, but could it be that we are all sawing at the branch on which we sit? And once it breaks, there will be a nationalist backlash soon that we will all feel very sorry about. Adding to the pressure, political movements are lurking ante portas, outside of Europe. These enthusiastically watch the weakening of Europe and applying pressure as at its weak points. The animosity of the Russian Federation is notorious and well documented. Difficult to miss are the intentions of the Islamist Jihad to derail Europe with terror attacks and create irritation and anger. This Europe, having soaked in democratic peace for 60 years, having enjoyed the reunification after decades of split, is surprised and realizes that the animosity from within and outside is not a bad dream, but sad reality. Europe has enemies. So far to the question in the crime scene, do you have enemies? Yes, we have. But those calling for a serious inspection of enemies to conduct some rational analysis counts as stuck in the Cold War mentality. However, critical evaluation of these anti-European Weltanschauung and opportunities is not a call for war, of course. We can identify three main strands that recently left their marginalized position and that are radically questioning Europe's way of life and Europe's values. We already mentioned the Islamist Jihad and the Russian autocracy as outside threats. The strongest domestic attack comes from the same nationalist authoritarian movement that had brought Europe to the brink of self-destruction in 1914 and 1939 already. It's a nationalism, a folkish nationalism, that responds to the crisis of the global economy with the delusion of an exclusive identity, instead of with the repair of the economy. Within this delusion, the own Volksgemeinschaft, the national community, ethnically based, is everything, and strangers and outsiders are to be excluded. Maybe that sounds a bit familiar to Americans in these days. The first example in my book is Anders Breivik. Anders Breivik executed this program, this identitarian program, to the dot 5 years ago by committing a massacre among the children of so-called, as he called them, Kulturmarxisten, cultural Marxists. He meant the Norwegian social democracy that widely opened doors for an alleged Muslim mass immigration. And that attack caused 76 deaths and many heavily injured. He justified all this in a long internet manifesto that I studied, in which he, for the year 2083, 400 years after the victory of the Christian armies of the Turks outside of Vienna, laid out his vision of a Europe free from Islam. Most Islamophobe bloggers, and we have a lot of them, that want to protect the Occident would not harm a fly, but their aggressive language and political fantasies correspond to Breivik's program to a certain degree. A significant and growing part of the formerly tax rebellious and Eurosceptical populists switched over to the nationalists. I think it's kind of no longer valuable to call people like Marine Le Pen or Viktor Orban, the Prime Minister of Hungary, populists. I think this is a diminishment of what they're doing. There are authoritarian nationalists, and this is far more right-wing than, let's say, the kind of populism that came up in Europe during the 70s. You know, tax rebels, critics of welfare state, etc. This is critics of Euro. It has completely changed. This is still in their programs, in their platforms. Euroscepticism, bashing of welfare state, and so on, and heavy taxes, etc. But the main argument is now Islam must leave Europe. A significant, they turn refugee immigration and Islam questions into the core question of European identity, an identity that should not be liberal, not be pluralist or cosmopolitan anymore. And by now, they have successfully forced this protectionist narrative on the European public, which doesn't talk about anything else anymore. I mean, this may also sound very familiar to you. Everybody's talking about Trump, and nobody's talking about, you know, the prospects of American nation, the prospects of American economy, etc. We're talking about the narrative that is given by populists and authoritarian nationalists. We're not talking about our agenda. But in Germany, for example, 80% of the population is strictly anti-populist and strictly against the right wing. So the press, the media focuses on their issues and neglects the issues of the future of Europe, which would be to discuss. They thus push the political elites to more or less willingly join the path of the renationalist thinking. The sad irony is that political entrepreneurs like Marine Le Pen, that feel Europe's future is threatened by Islam, are jeopardizing that very future. I think the most vicious person in this assembly of right-wing nationalists is Geert Wilders, the president of the Liberal Party, in Islamophobe party in the Netherlands. The domestic enemies kind of perfectly complement those from the outside, even if in a very surprising and unlikely fashion. To name two examples, which are also dealt with in my book. First is Alexander Dugin, the ideologue of Eurasian movement. That means a movement directed from Moscow by the Russian autocracy and to create an antipode to the Western alliances of Europe in bringing them back to the realm of former Soviet Union, focusing on the Eurasian land mass. This is a very interesting idea from the 20s and 30s, Raumpolitik, so a geopolitical idea. That the center of Europe, Germany, for example, doesn't belong to the Western alliances, to the Western world, to a liberal world, but belongs to the Eurasian landmass and has other aspects in terms of autocracy, etc. And the second example that I'm treating is Abu Musab al-Zuli. He's a Syrian-born ex-Al-Qaeda inventor of the small operational jihadist terror cells. This is exactly what is Europe facing now. You are aware of these attacks in Paris, in Brussels, in other cities. And the ideas realized by those terrorists are exactly outlined in a internet manifesto, a call for a global jihad, published by Abu Musab al-Zuli in 2004. So if you like, this is no longer the old-fashioned Al-Qaeda, the 9/11 Al-Qaeda. This is Al-Qaeda or other terrorist groups, in particular Al-Nusra, focusing on small terrorist cells and leaving them the liberty to act wherever they want in Europe as small cells. So these are the three examples I deal with in my book. Number one is Breivik, the identitarian. Number two is Dugin, the Eurasian. And number three is Abu Musab al-Zuli, the jihadist. You would ask, so what do they have in common? And the thought experiment is that you would put them into jail and put them together in one cell, and probably they would kill each other. And this is true, but if they are hindered to kill themselves, they would very soon find out the commonalities, in common is mostly that they are, and this is the title of my book, anti-European. Because during the long midnight discussions, they may discover astonishing similarities. Number one is the reintroduction of the concept of space, geopolitical space, into politics. That is a geopolitical rehabilitation of the nation or the imperium, the caliphate, the Eurasian autocracy, the Christian Abendland. These are no longer nation states. These are old-fashioned empires. And this is an exact counter vision to a Weltgesellschaft, a world society based on markets and supranational organizations. So here's the cleavage. Another similarity might be the concept of civilization as defined by sharp, partly bloody fringes. And there is also number three, a resacralization of politics. Religion and politics are no longer separate. The wall of separation is torn down. It's a that is guided by a religious Weltanschauung. And this is, of course, a push against the demystification of the world or the ensoulment of the world in the wake of the Enlightenment. And the modern day segregation of religion and politics, which is the target of Christian fundamentalism, of Russian Orthodox and Salafists alike. Here are the commonalities I'm talking about. These are also the elements of a political romanticism as propagated by conservative revolutionaries in the 20s and 30s. There is a direct allusion to conservative revolution. People like Oswald Spengler as a theorist of civilization, Julius Evola, one of the main figures of conservative revolutions in the 20th century. Oswald Spengler, I already mentioned, Carl Schmitt and others. So there's a reference to these authors by Breivik as well as by Dugin. The disciplines today recommend this as a strategy for cultural hegemony that is designed to first conquer the minds and then grab power. What I did is not going into details of these movements in at large, like the Eurasian movement, but digging out the intellectual origins and elements of these. It's a kind of intellectual history of these three approaches. Breivik should really hate Al-Suri, yet Islamism and Islamophobia seem like Siamese twins that are locking jaws and cannot leave each other to be. And Vladimir Putin and like-minded stand at the margins and use their chances that are arising from a pervasive sense of European nervousness that is accompanying the intellectual civil war in Europe. All the three wide writings, and one may add Donald Trump's confused speeches here, are just that, instigations for civil war. As marginal as these writings are, there are plenty of collaborationists, profiteers, and political entrepreneurs that use such blueprints even as they overlap thresholds of violence. Vladimir Putin has a strong following in Europe. The latest parties, particularly the CSU, the Bavarian branch of Christian Democrats, is very close to these Islamophobic ideas in telling that only Christian refugees can be accepted in Europe, no longer Muslim refugees. The statements of an East German CDU member calling the so-called Umvolkung, that was the Völkerungsaustausch, a kind of overhaul of the existing German majority population, are terminologically close to the identity concepts identified before, and with this, within Islamist milieus, the contempt for Europe and the West is on the rise too. So what I'm saying here is that these three people look very marginal, look very uninfluential, look very out of the point, but nevertheless they have their followers, they have their so-called moderate followers who kind of practice a Breivik without utoya, who practice a jihad without terrorism, who practice a Eurasian movement without terror. So, as I said, I'm more of an optimistic person. What I showed here was more a doomsday scenario for Europe. The point is, we have to identify these people and their indirect alliance, but we also have to think about the alternatives that we have. Europe is bound for peaceful development and has difficulties to resolutely resist these enemies. That already includes intellectual hesitation. The manifestos of Breivik, Dugin, and Al-Suri should not panic us, but they should be taken seriously. Their fight should receive more critical attention than the example given Adolf Hitler's Mein Kampf in the year 1925. If the sleep of the reason creates such monsters, Europe has to become reasonable. But it must also deliver a convincing message, a plausible narrative that enables a joint European experience. Our enemies are excellent in playing on political feelings and sentiments, and here we must offer a different, a better narrative of Europe, one that is different from the narrative provided by economic and political elites for the moment. The Europe that I find today is not fully my Europe. My Europe is an ecologically sustainable, socially just, and politically open community of states that focuses on the well-being of future generations, and that's what the majority now, in my opinion, has to push for. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you you very much for inviting me to this debate. And it is a pleasure to have the exchange of ideas here. Usually, if one comments, one starts with criticism. But in this case, I have to say I agree with the diagnosis of Klaus Leggewie. I could also join saying I'm usually an optimistic person, but the situation at the moment is really a catastrophe in Europe. So what I would like to do is to start where Klaus Leggewie ended. He says, well, we should think now as scholars about a way how we can have a narrative which is an alternative, which brings back rationality, not to have this the sleep of the rational, of the being rational, but also we need a narrative which is not just rational, but also gives citizens in the European Union a feeling of belonging to the European Union. So I think the emotional part we have also to take serious, because we need not just markets and not just experts and not just executives, but also I think a European public which is in favor of the European Union. So my argument might be that you say, oh, this is doomed to failure. I think we really have to think about a new start for Europe. Of course, one could say this is utopia, nobody will like it. But I think where we should first of all look, which I didn't do for a long time, but I was quite surprised, go to the Eurobarometer, which gives surveys about the public opinion in 28 member states of the European Union. And one is quite surprised, on the one hand, what you would expect, that the trust in this European Union has sort of fallen down in the last years. You can see that. But then, if you compare it, the trust, for example, at the moment into the European Union is on an average in 28 member states, 33% only into Europe. But then you look what is the trust of the same persons having been asked for their national parliament and their national government, and this is still less. So this is just one example, but you can have other examples also looking to what is, for example, what are the values, the European values, what European citizens treasure, and the three values they treasure most. And the value that has been on the rise very much has been the value of solidarity. So, which is also astonishing in a situation where many countries say we don't take refugees if they don't have a Christian belief. So the other thing is what really surprised me, if you look, should there be more competencies to the European level? Everybody would expect no. There is a majority saying no. But still, in the latest Eurobarometer, there is a, well, not big majority, but 51% of the European citizens who have been asked say we should have more competencies at the European level. So I think perhaps we should think a little about this, that it's not only just an elite-driven project, the European Union, but perhaps citizens are more in favor of that than we usually assume, in spite of the Euroscepticism, the rise of Euroscepticism, about 20% now already in many member states. So even then, we have to look to the majority of the citizens. This is why I would plead for having a real new reflection about the European Union, and my argument would be not going to the Europe of two speeds. Everybody is sort of in favor of that at the moment. A Europe of two speeds would be, in the end, functional units which are separated for different policies. So then you will never have an engagement of citizens for the European Union, because this is functionally, this is experts, this is separated. So this is why I think the idea of a Europe of two speeds does not make sense at the moment, though for everybody says, well, this is the most practical, the most realistic, we have to go there. Politicians are going there at the moment, the real situation in Europe is going there. Many scholars are going there. There was an edition of the London Review of Books where most of the scholars would be in favor of a Europe of two speeds. I think that this is a wrong alternative. We need common institutions, but on the basis of these common institutions, we should profit, we should use difference, which is a characteristic element, difference of culture, of religion, of politics, temporal difference, and use this for making a creative European Union. So I would not be against the difference of temporal structures, but I would say we should not use it to have separate units, but we should use it to have common institutions, and within these constitutions, put the differences on the table, take them seriously, but then make the best of it, try to transform it, even if it's not always we find a consensus. This is why, this would be my last point, I think even if everybody says this is utopian, this is doomed to be a failure, I think we need a new European Convention. And we should learn of the failures we did in the last European Convention. We must make a real conscious new start, not just, you know, muddling through, going on, trying somehow to overcome all these crises. So this European Convention then should make a multi-stage process, taking profit, making profit of the differences, of temporal differences in the European Union. First have a convention and working on a new text, which would be a constitutional treaty. But from the beginning, before you start that work, there should be a meeting of sort of the member states and making an agreement that in the end, the ratification would not need that everybody has to agree. So we would need a supermajority, and after such a European convention, the text should be given to a Europe-wide referendum, which would then have sort of a double majority. Not one member state can say no and the process is ended once and for all, but we would have sort of say, let's have the majority of all the citizens of the European Union plus a two-thirds majority of the member states. So this would have both aspects of Europe having sort of citizens but also having the member states. And I think if citizens would know this in advance, that they will have a voice in the process, and this voice counts, it's not just symbolical, then they also would be interested. And of course, the political price of such a project would be that not all member states would participate in that. I think we have to take this. We cannot think that all the 27 member states which are left now would agree to such a development. But even if they are, perhaps they are more than we think now in this critical moment, but even if they are less, it would be a conscious political decision, which I think is the only realistic way to get out of this crisis. Thank you.
I never really like holding a microphone, but I guess I'm going to have to do it. I want to thank Professors Leggewie and Landfried for very illuminating comments. And I guess I want to say, to start with, that I, in a certain sense, feel like I'm speaking more as a citizen than particularly as an expert on these issues. But I've certainly been, and I tend to be an optimistic guy too, but I guess I've also been seized by the very least the gravity of the situation in which we seem to find ourselves. And, you know, what struck me most about Professor Leggewie's remarks and his description of the book that he's written has indeed to do with the parallels with the United States. And those are, it seems to me, rather striking. The, for one thing, the extensive renationalization of politics. The critique of globalization that, you know, has really dominated the electoral campaign in the United States, certainly at least from the right and the left, that have brought, you know, a critique of free trade and international engagement to the fore in a way that I think we haven't seen them in quite some time. The second has been a kind of an appeal to emotions rather than to reason. We will never return to the manufacturing economy of the mid-20th century. We're producing, you know, roughly the same amount in manufacturing as we did back then. We're just doing it with a lot fewer people now. And we're not going to sort of reconstruct that mid-20th century economy, but Donald Trump tells his followers that, you know, I will fix it, which is the kind of rhetoric that, again, I don't want to, you know, invoke scare scenarios, but there are hints in his language that for anybody with a passing familiarity with 20th century German history have to be a source of concern. And of course, most worrisomely, there is the more or less open flirtation with violence. And the fact that violence is in a kind of covert, wink-wink sort of way, potentially at least being encouraged in the election that we're about to have. And you know, that is the sort of thing that we're not, I think, by and large, so used to. I mean, there were times in the South in this country where violence at election time was a staple thing, but it's not been something that's been a national phenomenon, at least in a long time. So, I mean, obviously I'm primarily talking about Donald Trump, but there's a way in which it seems to me Trump and Clinton reflect sort of the poles of the Europe that Professor Leggewie describes. Trump encourages a kind of conspiratorial view of politics, of a country being stolen by dark international forces, and he's describing those forces in tones, in terms that have echoes of mid-20th century, early 20th century anti-Semitic slogans. Hillary Clinton, meanwhile, for all her commanding command of policy, is unable to articulate a compelling vision of where the country should go. And this kind of reminded me of a comment that Zbigniew Brzezinski made in a recent book in which he said that, you know, the problem with Europe is that the extent of its political vision right now is that it wants to become the world's most comfortable retirement home. And that vision is obviously facing a lot of problems. So had Trump not undermined his candidacy by attacks and slurs on the vulnerable of all kinds, he might actually be winning, because the real thing that it seems to me is on trial here is, you know, what in the 60s was called the system, or is sometimes now called the establishment, which is seen by, you know, those on, I think, the extremes, but particularly in Trump's base, is seen as working only for the well-off. I mean, Democrats and Republicans, or supporters of Hillary, supporters of Trump, seem to see this differently. They see the system working well for the wealthy, whereas Clinton supporters seem to see it as working primarily for whites rather than the wealthy per se. But nonetheless, there's this kind of broad-scale rejection of the system or the establishment. And I want to venture that the underlying reason has something to do with a transition to a new kind of economy that has undermined the position of the working and middle classes of the developed parts of the world, the former so-called first world. There is a bright side to this that our colleague here at the Graduate Center, Branko Milanovic, has written about in a recent book on global inequality, and that is that people in the other parts of the world are actually, relatively speaking, doing a lot better. This particularly has to do with, you know, shifts to market policies in India and China, which make up roughly 40% of global population, and hence anything that happens there has a big effect on averages. But what Professor Milanovic has shown is that in the sort of working and lower middle classes in the developed world, economic income growth has essentially been non-existent for the last 30 years. And that I think is what is the reaction to that we're seeing. And I think the fact that there's a bright side to some of these developments is, of course, cold comfort to those who've been experiencing this stagnation, or worse, since the 1970s. The shift to what one might call a smart economy is eliminating many occupations, perhaps more than ever before, and is raising questions about the future relationship between work and income. So the kind of world that we're entering into, it seems to me, is one that's very murky and hard to make out. What's clear is that many people in the first world are being deprived of their expectations of continuing improvements in their standard of living, as they had thought was sort of a birthright. They're therefore turning to borders and to their neighbors in search of better days and the good old days. And I think your emphasis on the search for solidarity and community is part of the story here, is the kind of search for old certainties that one found in immediate solidarities and that sort of thing. So I think one of the big questions that troubles me, I guess, is, you know, why did so many of us not really see this coming? To answer Klaus Leggewie's question about whether the deceased had enemies, we might note that even paranoids have enemies. But what needs explaining is why we haven't been more paranoid, or at least more aware, that this rejection of the establishment was brewing. And, you know, American exceptionalism notwithstanding, it seems to me, to have become more European, at least for the time being, than we had been heretofore. So let me conclude there, and I guess I'm just supposed to open the floor for questions. So please stand up and tell us who you are, or raise your hand and tell us who you are, and ask your question.
Excuse me, it is not a question, it is only an observation, if it is possible. And I ask you to excuse my very bad English. Everywhere I go for such lectures about Europe, I went last week to French consulate, and there was such a lecture. It is always the same question. We don't arrive to realize Europe, what to do to make it. There is something who is lacking. And perhaps you will not find my conclusion very original, but I think that the only thing who can unite us in Europe is a religion, not integrist religion, any religion, but we are all Christian first. And what make the union in the United States? It is precisely Protestant Reformation allied to the Enlightenment. And we need to do that in Europe. You have countries like Germany who are Protestant, but all the economy of Germany is made of this Protestant Reformation. It makes, like in the United States, it makes a very great marchand, un pays de marchands. In France, we are secular, but France is very particular thing because it has been during 1,000 years Catholic, a religious country. I say that France says we are secular, but it is a very, very religious and mystical country, because revolution was a mysticism. It was not a rationalistic thing. Robespierre, Jean-Jacques Rousseau were completely mystical.
Is there a question here? It
is an observation. So I say, if we want to do Europe, we must make a religious Europe. It is only that we could unite about the transcendence. I have nothing else to say.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, just a quick answer. Completely the other side. My opinion is completely the opposite. The problem is, I lived in France for many years, and the problem exactly is that Catholicism, a very integrist Catholicism, is coming back, and it's kind of nurturing the right wing. And in Germany, the same happens now as people who reclaim the Christian Abendland. Most of them have never visited a church at all. those people you can see in Dresden on the streets claiming a patriotic front against the Islamization of the Christian Abendland are exactly, to speak with Max Weber, they are religiously, not musically at all. So the point is that the wall of separation has to be higher and not lower.
Well, I would join this answer because I think our task in Europe is to deal now with difference of religion. So we have now become in a situation where we must find ways that we don't have confrontations just between religions. So one of the bases to have this debate is a strict separation between politics and between religion. I think we should not go back and say we are just a Christian Europe. I think if you would ask what is European, you say it's a Christian, it's Christian religion. I would say that we have learned in the European Union all these catastrophes we had in the 20th century to reflect upon the reasons how this happened and to be aware of these dangers. And I think this is European to be aware of such dangers and not just let it happen again. So this is why I think this is European, but not the religion.
As a matter of fact, Europe has to be congratulated that in spite of enormous pressure by the church, that God does not appear in the prologue of the European Union. It was quite a battle, and I was very much concerned because there is a very good book out by the former chief rabbi of England, Jonathan Sacks. And the book is called Not in the Name of God, because all these wars were fought in the name of God. So anybody who wants God should think 10 times before.
Go to church, stay there.
Hi, I'm Christian Meijer from the Center of European and Mediterranean Studies. I have a question to both Professor Leggewie and Professor Landfried. But I would like to ask my question by pointing to a contradiction in what you both said. That contradiction is that we have to go back to a rational discourse about Europe, about European integration. We have to think about the institutions that we could build based on such a discourse. On the other side, you both mentioned that we have to provide a feeling of belonging to the citizens in Europe. Whereas Leggewie mentioned emotions, that they play a big role. Isn't that exactly playing the same game that the identity movement is playing, that the right-wing conservative is playing, the longing for romanticism in politics? Mm-hmm. Shouldn't we go forward by saying we want to be rational and we don't care for narratives of belonging? We achieve the feeling of belonging by introducing policies that address the actual questions that are underlying this demand for a narrative. That is, more redistribution, better education, healthcare, and so on. These seemingly boring everyday policies that actually make people's lives better. That will be my question. Thank you.
Now, this is the most interesting question for Europe now. Not all kind of emotion work we might think about are in the direction of the identitarian movement, the belonging. I'm very skeptical about identity politics of all kinds of identity politics. I very much agree. When I was in New York, there was this famous article about class is more important than race, etc. I think this is what has to be taught in Europe in these days. Nevertheless, for example, my colleague Ivan Krastev, who is often in New York and a contributor to the New York Times, he has exactly this point that the construction of Europe as a very rational one, and I agree, we should have these boring issues treated all the time. Nevertheless, there's a lack of not a sense of belonging, but of emotional investment into Europe. And my idea to what Christine said about the investment in the future of Europe is exactly to create, and we are doing this in all over Europe, is to create a network which is called Praxis Europa, Praxis Europe. Because I think, my sense is, you know, from my institute and from many discussions in Germany, that people, you know, let's say in the middle, in the center, let's talk about people between 30 and 50 years old, are now realizing that we have something to lose. We're at the brink. We have to do something. It's not self-evident that Europe goes on, etc. And what I would like to bring in is exactly this emotional reaction to the right wing, not in the sense of, okay, we create a kind of left-wing identity politics, no. In terms of what we're doing is Europe, every day. Because if you listen to people and ask them, so what do you think about Europe, you have a much better general opinion, and this is what I mentioned to Christine Landfried before, but you also have very strong relations to Europe, mostly unconscious, mostly not really rationalized in that sense. And this is the kind of emotion I would appeal to. So a network of people in the center of Europe, maybe beyond left and right in this sense, and you know, what are we doing every day is exactly Europe. This is just that was the idea to recreate Interrail. For those who are a bit older, know exactly that Interrail was the opportunity to travel through Europe for not very much money. So, and this is what I have in mind is it's just a metaphorical Interrail idea of Europe. People are working every day, people are experiencing Europe every day, and this is what has to come out now. And this doesn't. This is not an alternative to institutional reform or to a normative order. Europe has some values, etc. But this is, let's say, a bit closer to what I would call political emotionality of a different kind. And so there is this tension. There is this. It doesn't have to be out of balance, of course. But I think Krasov has a point when he says, you know, politics in Europe is coined in terms of there is no alternative. There is no alternative. And politics is living from having alternatives, having true alternatives for the future. And I very much agree that we have to skip, you know, from spatial dimensions, Europe as a constellation of nation states, to temporal constellations in terms of future generations and the future of Europe, let's say 2030, 2050. You know, we have all signed the agreement in Paris and in New York concerning sustainability and climate protection. This is now a kind of new universal rule. And it may sound very abstract, but creating such a sustainable Europe is exactly what I'm talking about. And this may enhance some political emotionality.
So my answer would also be to start, you are right, there is this tension. And I'm also very much against identity politics, because this ends up exactly where we don't want to be. But I think the one I'm a big adorer of Jürgen Habermas' theory of the public opinion, public sphere, but it's not only about rational politics. I agree that, of course, it would be the best thing to do for Europe if we could fight youth unemployment. These practical things are not minor things. But we also need a sense of, let's say, when we have such a crisis in the European Union, as at the moment, multiple crises, there should be a feeling, let's do something about these crises, but not how can we leave, what are our interests, what are our costs and benefits, how many do we take. I think the tasks are so challenging at the moment. With the refugees, we cannot solve this by saying we take 1,000, we take 2,000. No, there must be a feeling to say we have to solve this together. And looking to the Eurobarometer, it's interesting how much people are much more in favor than we think. There is now a new book about Islam everyday life. I think there where Europe is decided in the end, I would agree with Klaus, is everyday life on the bottom. And Nili Fergöhler, a sociologist, she would make talks, round tables with Muslims and non-Muslims talking about their everyday life in the European Union. And the really interesting thing is that these people are not in the big political debates, but many of these Muslims, you could see, they have developed sort of feeling, not just against the European Union, it's their everyday life. And I think there we have to go to see, it's not black and white, what is in between, how can we live together with these many religions now, these many cultures. This is about rational politics, this is very important, but also about a public debate which takes seriously this emotional part. So for example, everybody would say the referendum in Greece, where it was clear what would be the end and the outcome, this was just about sort of populist politics. I don't think so. The people in Greece wanted to debate about this and wanted sort of to have a voice in that, even knowing that it has no rational effect. So I think we should take this also seriously, though I admit it is a tension.
Mechtild Schmidt-Weist from NYU. It's okay, I think I can just speak without. So if I listen to the combination of problems, I agree there's a problem in Europe, but I wonder, since we're talking about Europe, we're talking about the USA, we're talking about the Near East, if this isn't a systemic problem, and that would be my question to you. And sorry, I'm really bad with names, but Mr. Torpey already mentioned that we have problems of inequality, and I think also all problems of identification are that you can identify with your neighbor, with your immediate community, and it's very hard to identify with a multinational corporation. Maybe you could identify with a Ford factory if you were, you know, making Fords mid-century and they were for your country and your people and you could buy one. So I think our economic and financial structures have been so abstract that people cannot identify with them, and that, you know, maybe the elites on the economic and political level only saw their circles, and, you know, we've been sort of laughing at people like Trump or the supporters of them, and unfortunately names like deplorable have been used. But by ignoring these people and not taking their concerns seriously, we actually drive them to the right. I don't think they're necessarily in the right, but they feel disadvantaged. They feel they have no role in the digital economy. They don't have the education to get new jobs. And so the right-wing populist function as a big pool of the disenfranchised, you could say. So my question is that, do you think the problem can be solved in Europe, or is this something that has to be solved on a much higher level?
Well, the first thing I would answer is that there is a multinational corporation called Facebook, which gets a lot of identification. I mean, this is true for, if you look at maybe Volkswagen at the moment. But in general, to be serious, I would agree that a certain kind of globalization has contributed to the problems we're talking about. But of course, the myth of saying, you know, people in Akron, Ohio, they vote Trump because they have lost their jobs. The majority of Trump voters is more than $80,000 average income. So most of it is a panic in the middle classes, as Theodor Geiger would have called it in 1930. And I think this is a more psychological problem that we are having here as a socioeconomic problem. I'm not saying that people in Akron, Ohio will go, so they don't care, not at all. I think we have to care. And there are a lot of books out now about the situation. For example, there's this book by a French sociologist, Didier Ribon, who comes from a family of from national members and supporters, and he comes back as a sociology professor to his neighborhood, and he kind of feels this alienation of people. So problem is the anti-globalization movements we have remind me the situation before World War I or in the 20s, 30s in Europe. And in that sense, Trump, as you said, and I very much agree, is a very European phenomenon. It's It's a very European phenomenon. I think the irritation of the GOP concerning Trump is exactly he's not like us. He's not an American right-wing guy. He sounds like a European. He sounds like a mini Mussolini or whatever, a proto-fascist of this kind. I think this is the answer to the, and this is why he was so successful, because he brought something new to the discourse and rhetoric of American politics. And so the alternative to a, let's say, failed globalization in that sense, relating to free trade, is not stopping globalization. It's creating new elements within globalization. Make globalization socially more just, inclusive, politically open. This is the thing. We are just writing a paper for the G20 summit next year for the German government, because Germany has the presidency of the G20, which exactly brings together these questions of sustainability, climate protection, etc., etc., environmental politics, and social justice question, and democracy question. I think this is also an issue that might be emotionally attractive to younger generations. So I'm not saying stop globalization. Many of the radical left are claiming exactly the same in Greece, in France, etc. Stop globalization. Stop Europe in terms of a kind of branch of globalization. No, let's have continuing globalization politics with different. Let's call it alter mondialisation. This is the French expression, an alternative globalization, I think. And then people can have a perspective against in Akron, Ohio, in Essen, where my institute is, in the Ruhr area, and in many other places, in Valenciennes, in France. So we have to create not just a resentment against, you know, this kind of globalization. We have to create alternatives, and investment, innovation can be possible. Yeah. And so this would be my answer to the interesting question: whatever happened to the American working class? Whatever happened to the class ouvrière en France? Whatever happened to the working class in Germany? That's what happened. And there was always a tension in working labor movements, you know, of xenophobic and internationalist solidarity and a very nationalist approach, a protectionist approach. And what is kind of lacking now is an alternative vision for these working classes or the middle classes. Tony Judd would have called them social democracy.
Well, just also a short answer. I think it's a very important question you have asked. What is the systemic problem beyond Europe? Isn't there something all over also globalization? So I think one systemic problem really is that we have a breathtaking speed of technological development, but we don't shape it politically anymore. And so I think this is, with the details, just also what Klaus said, just to get this again into political shaping, for this we need Europe. Just one short example. Now that Apple should pay taxes in Europe, this is only the European Union who can pressure that. This is not one nation state in the European Union. Yes. And I think these are the examples to take and say, well, we need also these regional regional who have really power to influence technological change and not just let it go and make it in a way that we as democratic societies think it should be. So in so far, it has a systemic problem. I would absolutely agree. But I think to tackle with that problem, we need also something like the European Union, because then we are stronger. Great Britain will not do it. They are absolutely wrong with their Brexit thinking. They become now a global player, a real global player. With Apple, they are lost.
I have a question related more to Germany than Europe. For the past several generations, the German state has had what might I call a love affair with let's call it the region of Turkey, starting with Bismarck and with the Kaiser before and after the First World War, the interwar period, I would argue even up to World War II, judging by the neutrality of Turkey in that struggle. Had that siren call of both the Ottoman Turkey and then Kemalist Turkey was perceived by the German leadership as being advantageous, you know, to its geopolitical standing. It had nothing to do with religion, as far as I could see. It was really strictly geography. But is that issue dead? Because it would confuse and delay the rational thought that needs to be observed, as you noted correctly.
Thank you.
But the siren call is still around, as noted by the recent rapprochement between Russia and Turkey, two historical enemies that, you know, ostensibly are now friendly. So what worries me is that, you know, these types of calculations can still go on in the face of a united Europe.
I think this is a very interesting question. First point, Germany and the Turks, or Germans and Turks, I think the love affair has kind of changed into an ordinary marriage. Many of the problems. But you stick to the marriage. So one of the most important aspects of German domestic politics is now how to stick to policies we have. It's a dangerous thing for the moment. It's not just against asylum seekers, refugees. It can every day turn into a resentment against the Turks who are living in Germany since decades, and most of them having now the citizenship. I was very much fighting for this citizenship reform, in which happened in 2000, very late, nevertheless. So this is problem number one. Problem number two is that the alliance between Putin and Erdogan, which is, in my view, a very superficial one, not based on, let's say, deep agreements. Exactly. So, thank you. No, but it kind of illustrates exactly what I was trying to say in my book about renaissance of a very authoritarian style and in politics. And here, Orban, Kaczynski, Putin and Erdogan are very close, not because they have ideological agreements, no, because their style of politics is completely the same. It's an authoritarian alternative. They call it illiberal democracy. This isn't just we coined them, we termed them illiberals. No, they call themselves illiberal democrats. They say we have a majority, it's a very plebiscitarian form of democracy, kind of claiming. There was this referendum in Hungary. Are you in favor of refugees? No. Okay. Yes. Nevertheless, he lost this referendum, which is a sign of hope. No, this is a new style in politics, and it comes exactly, you know, from the challenge authoritarian nationalism poses to the European democracies, and we are too defensive. We are not really coming out and saying no. We are 80% in Germany. Particularly, we have 80% in favor of this kind of democracy, and we evaluate it, we cherish it. Yeah. So we have to come out as a majority. They claim to be a silent majority, coming out now, finally, and having a voice. The same happened in France. No, it must be the opposite. It's just a minority, and they have to stick to this position.
I've got a question about referring to identity and identity politics as well as identification. If I understand you correctly, you're saying that there are more rational and more emotional points of identification or not identification with the European Union and the concept of Europe. And you're also talking about creating a new narrative for Europe. If that is the case, and if we are really looking for a new narrative or new goals, you were already describing a process of reinventing a narrative by inclusion or by including different perspectives. But how would that actually work? Like, could you take that a little bit further, and could you explain a little bit more what you would envision? You were referring to one point in terms of, you know, sustainability and climate change, but could you elaborate on that a little bit further?
I just read an article in New York Times today that climate change is no point of the discussion in the campaign now. This is awful. I mean, this is the most important thing. This is just the opinion of a green German, you know. Let them go. No, it's the most important point for the future of our kids and our grandkids. Sorry to be so pathetic. No, it is the most important thing to get climate change, to get climate protection done. And instead of saying, oh, well, this will cost a lot of costs and we have to strain from our habits, etc., etc., it creates hundreds of opportunities for business, for the economy in general, for future generations, for young unemployed people in Spain or in Portugal or in Greece. You know, for example, if it's just a small example, Greece is 100% depending on oil imports for its energy production. 100%. A country where you have much more sun than in Germany, maybe like now in New York, you never know. You have other opportunities for alternative energy. So this is our discussion relay. You know, there was this austerity politics policies driven by very much by our Chancellor Merkel and by the EU Commission, and this was a deep error to do this, not creating an alternative for these economies and societies, and particularly for the young people who are now like 50 or 60% unemployed. No, we should have set up a project, you know, exactly in this direction, and this would create so many opportunities. Why are we missing this? Why are we talking about, you know, the whole thing we're talking about is locker room conversation, sorry. Yeah, it's so unimportant what it really is on the table here. We have really interesting options for with the sustainability thing. And, you know, we all signed this agreement, UN agreement in November 2015, and the Paris Agreement, a couple of days say that this creates hundreds of opportunities. And believe me, it's not just a romantic idea of a green Germany. This is a project for the world economy. It creates investment, it creates innovation, it creates ideas of all kinds. And it changed the topic. We are no longer, you know, in this decadent speech. So it's, oh, everything is going down. No, there is a future. And we have to do this for a future. I think we should really change the approach, change the focus, change, and this is why we have to become emotional in that. Mm-hmm. It's about future generations and not about, you know, everything in identity politics is from the past, you know. Khalifa, so I don't care, really, yeah? And this must be made clear and not, you know, coming back to all these kinds of. No, it created commonalities in Europe. Of course, it's Christendom interesting for Europe. Of course, many sources of our constitution stemming from Christian ideas. But nevertheless, there was a kind of secularization, and we have to go on. Most aspects of identity politics are really driven by the past, and not inspired by the future.
And perhaps just to add, one could then say, because you asked, how do you play, elaborate about it, what the profit of difference would be, then there are different approaches in the member states how to deal with sustainability and environmental politics. In Great Britain, they measure more what is coming out of the industry, in Germany, more what is the quality of the air. French politics is again different, they have much more state politics. So I think the thing is, in Europe, to put all these differences on the table and find a way how to profit, you can combine, you know? You can combine things which are better there or better there, or, you know, I think making some more creative way of dealing with all these differences, approaches in politics, but really looking to the future. I think this is very important. This is why this identity politics is really out of, I think we should, this is not, it's not a way to think about that.
Yes, you just brought up Greece, and I spent 6 weeks there last summer, and I'm wondering why the European Union has not been able to help Greece with all the refugees coming from Syria. They're parked there, I mean, the Greek people have nothing, they're suffering, and yet there seems to be nothing really. I mean, they talk about, you know, helping, but it's really not working. Why is that? Why is it so impossible?
Reason number one is, of course, a wrong policy, particularly in Germany, by our Minister of Finance, by the Chancellor too. I mean, I very much agree with Merkel in terms of refugee crisis, etc., but this ends in Greece. Exactly. So there should have been a deal if Greece is now forced to protect the richer parts of Europe from refugees, which is the truth, the cynical truth, then at least we should have relaxed our austerity rules. But the other point is that exactly the left-wing government in Greece, Syriza, is also not interested in these kind of alternatives. If you go there and ask people, so why you have this is a country, plenty of sun, plenty of water, plenty of wind, and can create a kind of focus for, you know, energy policies all over the Western Balkans. They look at you and say, what are you talking about? Are you green from Germany or what? Yeah. So this is not really esteemed. Syriza is very much, you know, on this left-wing populist thing. They are in a coalition with a right-wing populist party. Yeah? They are very much into the past in terms of let's recreate a community of Orthodox churches in Russia, in Greece, and in Serbia. So this is, if you read the newspapers. So both are not really what I would say. I'm just a professor, you know, but I would argue this is more important to deal with investment in the future instead of dreaming about a kind of reunified Orthodox, Christian Orthodox community all over the Eastern Europe.
I don't think that's true, though. I mean, I am a Greek American, Greek Orthodox. I have not heard one word. I mean, I don't think that Orthodoxy is that intense as you would believe it to be. In fact, very few people go to church in Greece, good or bad or different.
Yeah, I'm not talking about people in Greece.
I mean, politicians, I haven't heard, you know, people, Greeks are constantly talking.
Yeah, but there are these conversations between the Minister of Defense from Anel and the Putin administration exactly about this, and there's a new big church sponsored by Putin in the center of Athens. So excuse me, there is.
Russian
church. Russian church, of course.
Well, perhaps also with Greece, I think the point is one should have, you know, everybody in the European Union said, well, they have a bad administration, which is true, they don't collect taxes. So that's the problem about Greece. But now, in this situation, European would be to say, this is a crisis also of the European Union, it was a crisis of the banks, and we have to go in and not with austerity politics. We have really to deal with the real problems. When it was discussed, for example, if they would sell, you know, some of their islands, imagine, there should be an outcry that Greece should sell islands, saying, well, this is our tradition. Democracy comes from Greece. So there is a crisis and we have to go in and not just say what is the use of it. So this was all the debate, and austerity politics was, I think, a big mistake, which, you know, now everybody says, well, it's too late now to change it, and, you know, little changes are done. But it was a failure of European politics. Greece is a good example. And the Greek experts say you have sort of really worked a lot of with the Commission. Georgette Lalisse, she's a colleague who has been here from the Commission last year at NYU. And she said there was a huge belief in the International Monetary Fund to solve this, but not in the European institutions. The elite, we always say, oh, the citizens don't believe in Europe. The elite didn't believe in its own institutions.
Bernard Brown, political science here at the Graduate Center. There's an 800-pound gorilla in the room that we haven't been talking about, and that's the British exit, Brexit. That's an electroshock in Europe. I mean, everything has been turned around because of the Brexit, and we have to raise the question, what does it mean for the European Union? Is it pointing to some serious problems? Well, it is, of course, but what's the relationship of the European Union to these problems? Has the Union been creating the problems? Is the union going to be capable of resolving the problems? Well, you have to first identify the problems. The central issue, I have the impression here that we're all underestimating the seriousness of the problem. Central issue was a sense that people had lost control of immigration policy. The society was changing. They didn't like it. Now, maybe we can say, look, if you discuss everyday life with your Muslim neighbors, you'll all come out much happier. That's not going to happen. I mean, you have to take this, it seems to me, as a fact of life. The French, for example, are confronting a serious problem, the Bataclan carnage, the carnage in Nice. This is affecting how people look at the politics of the state, their own identity, and at the European Union. Now, I'll give you just one example of how it's a problem of the union. Family reunions. For the French, this becomes a serious problem. Family reunions is one of the major reasons why it's hard to control immigration now. And you have a greater rate of immigration now of people who are, from the French point of view, many of the French creating problems. You have a greater rate of immigration now that's beyond control. Part of it is because of European Union regulations. So you have the issue of controlling waves of immigration, changing the fabric, the social fabric of important countries and how people look at it, whether we like it or not, it's happening. We talked about the fate of the working class. Okay, now the question is, what can be done? What's the lesson from the British exit? More European Union? Creating a federal state through a national convention? Good luck with that. I mean, I don't think that's gonna happen. Less European Union? Well, what does that mean in terms of strengthening the state? Which way do you go? Strengthening the union? And is it possible? And if not, what's plan B?
How many hours do we have? No, I don't think that the Brexit and the French reaction has anything to do with the refugee crisis. Not at all, because France and the UK have very few refugees in these recent years. It's just a small.
Really, the immigration.
So the problem, the immigration with the Brits is nothing special. There are hundreds of thousands of people from Pakistan, India, no problem with them. So it's about Europe. The problem they have is with the Polish plumber. Sorry to be a bit polemical now. So you can, I experience this in London, that people are kind of yelled at because they are Polish. Because there is a, I mean, I understand these concerns, we have lost control, but I think it's an illusion that, you know, the restitution of borders and national sovereignty will solve the problem. It will exactly make it more salient. Because if you stop the European integration process, you will have no cooperation structures in Europe at all. So then you can argue with Viktor Orban, well, it's a German problem. That's what he said when he stopped refugees at the Austrian border, and he said, oh, well, I have nothing to do with the whole problem because it's a German problem. So all people are going to Germany, and this is stopping European solidarity. It's stopping European cooperation. It's blaming the Germans for creating a problem But they were the only one of the rare countries next to the Swedes and some others who really took care of the problem. You can, of course, create the illusion that borders, Obergrenzen, upper limits for immigration, etc., will solve the problem. But then you have no clue what globalization is about, how the situation in Syria is, how the situation in most African countries is. Of course you can say, well, we have to stick to national sovereignty. You know, the one problem that was raised mostly by Farage and others was the democracy problem, because it's our democracy and we have to decide. This is indeed a problem Christine already addressed in terms of how can we change institutional orders in that in the European Union, that national democracies count. There I would agree, but for the rest, the immigration, it's just an excuse. Because, I repeat, nobody takes care of I would say, millions of Pakistani Indians. I don't either, but I'm okay with them. But no, this was not against immigration. It was a certain kind of European integration. It has nothing to do with refugees because they all stop in Calais. And they all stop at Heathrow Airport, you know, these millions of immigrants, Farage and others were talking about. And I think this is exactly the same as with Trump. Build a wall. I mean, come on, this is not how you deal with a global interconnected world. We don't have the duty for a new declaration of independence, but for a new declaration of interdependence. That's how the situation is. Maybe it creates a lot of problems, but this is the situation. Globalization is not just this one way.
So, okay. Thank you very much. I want to thank our two speakers for a fascinating discussion of the challenges that I think we face both in Europe and in the United States at the moment. Despite what I said about Donald Trump being a European figure, American exceptionalism persists in the sense that we're talking about sex in the campaign and not about climate change, which Europeans are tearing their hair out about. But it seems to me, you know, across the pond, we both face a kind of challenge that has to do with something like inclusive capitalism and something about things like Oliver Moss's old idea of constitutional patriotism. How do you get people to feel strongly about, you know, these institutions, which they seem to feel distant from? But in any case, thank you all for coming, and thank you to our various sponsors and to our speakers, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.
Ich bin der Meinung, dass wir uns nicht mehr so gut verstehen.
Yeah.